wonderful to be here. And you know, I was actually thinking, Dan, that you said there were three ways to connect. But I want to actually talk about a fourth way and use the word connect in a context of our brains and our brain connections. And I want to pose a question, which is, can we grow new synapses in old brains? And anyhow, for that I really mean, can we grow new synapses in my old brain? You can decide if you want to grow them in your old brain. So what do I mean by a synapse, and why should we care about synapses? And let me just first say, you are your synapses. Synapses are the connection between one nerve cell and the next. And there are, of course, billions of nerve cells and billions of synapses in your brain. And synapses change with learning. And that's especially true in the baby's brain during critical periods of development. I'm going to talk about that more in a minute. Memories are stored at synapses. And so part of the devastating effects of Alzheimer's disease is that synapses are lost in Alzheimer's disease, also in other neurodegenerative disorders and stroke and traumatic brain injury. And wouldn't it be great if you could somehow make new synapses in old brains or damaged brains? And that's really the question that I want to answer. Now, here's a thought. If we could understand the molecular and cellular underpinnings that actually regulate these amazing early critical periods of development, when children just seem to be like sponges and they can learn anything they want, could we then engage those mechanisms to repair the brain or to make new synapses? And I have some good news for you. So, at least in mice, what we know are that the components are present in the adult brain, but they're kind of braked. And it's possible to take the brakes off and actually increase the amount of plasticity that's present in the adult brain. And that's what I want to explain next. So first of all, let me just explain what I mean by critical period for learning. And you know that perfectly well, or at least I do, because pitifully, I mean, I am a native English speaker, and I've tried to learn French as an adult. Okay, I can learn French as an adult. I mean, we continue to learn after critical periods. It's not like the window slams shut. But I can't learn without an accent. And yet, I know an accent. So those in the know, I got nice going, right? Wow, very sophisticated group. So, you know, but of course, as a child, you can learn 1, 2, 3, 4 languages. It's very easy to learn language, at least through puberty. And that's a great example of a critical period of development, a period during which you have to experience and learn and rehearse in order to actually master. Now, can we understand these critical periods and animal models where we could actually go into the brain and look at the synapses and the molecules and the genes? Well, the last time I heard, mice were not learning French as a second language. But in fact, just like us, mice have 2 eyes. And you know, just think about this really cool paradox. So we have 2 eyes, both see the world, but we only have 1 view of the world that we experience, unless there's pathology and you see double. So that's really amazing, right? We have to somehow, in our brain, the brain circuits have to put together the 2 views of the world into a seamless whole single world view. And this is true in us, it's true in mice. And let me just show you the first few steps in brain wiring for vision that gives this binocular view of the world. And you can just see that the outputs from the 2 eyes, the neurons in the eyes, send their connections to this relay station in the brain called the LGN. By the way, they make a synapse in the LGN, or synapses, many of them. And that's the first place where the 2 eyes start to get together. And they're like neighbors in the LGN. But by the time they get to the next step in visual information processing, they actually have become interdigitated with each other. And you can see that right eye, left eye, red, green, red, green. And you can visualize in an animal model this beautiful interdigitation of the synapses in the primary visual cortex by injecting one eye with a non-toxic tracer, and which can be white, and it's going to be in the next picture. And then you can look in the cortex at the synapses that are representing the eye that was injected. And amazingly, here you can really see this beautiful separation of right eye, left eye. It's really, we have, every one of us has one of these patterns in our brain. And at this scale, those white things are actually like supposed to be grains of rice. So every little dot in that image is about the size of a synapse. And you can see these millions of synapses, with the right eye being white, all the connections from the white eye, and the black area would represent the territory occupied by synapses from the black, the other eye, the uninjected eye. And when neuroscientists first saw this gorgeous pattern, they thought, it had to be hardwired. How could you possibly have a pattern like this, leaving it to chance? But a number of years ago, David Hubel and Torsten Wiesel, who then won the Nobel Prize for their work on this subject, wanted to study why children with congenital cataracts are blind in the eye that had the cataract unless it's fixed early after birth. And what they did is they made an animal model of cataract, just simply closing the eyelids of one eye, just like the kid would have. And then they traced the connections from the open eye, the white stuff again. And what they discovered was unbelievably amazing. That is, the open eye kind of took over the synapses in most of the visual cortex. And the closed eye was left in these piddly little black holes. And this was one of the most graphic demonstrations of use it or lose it, and the idea that the brain actually has experience tunes up circuits in the brain. Oh, and by the way, you know, actually, your synapses are tuning up right now unless you're sleeping. And actually, though, you know, you'd think it's kind of risky to have this kind of change happen in your brains, you know, while you're listening to my lecture. And actually, I have to tell you, there's good news, and that is that this kind of wholesale change that you see during is mainly happening during development. So our synapses are changing as, you know, we learn and remember, but there's smaller tweaks that are happening as adult. Now, what's going on actually during these early critical periods of development? So what's really happening is that synapses are being made or pruned. So it turns out that in the baby's brain, we're all born with more synapses than we have in adult brain. And during these critical periods, through a process of use it or lose it, synapses are being selected to be kept or eliminated, so pruning or retention. And this process is going on during these critical periods of development, and then the circuits kind of stabilize so as we get to adults. Wouldn't it be great if we could somehow reactivate that process and restore synapses to the aging brain? So how can we do that? Well, we have to find mechanisms and molecules. And to make a really long story short, we can do that in mice. We can look in their brains. And I want to just tell you about one, which is a mouthful. It's called paired immunoglobulin-like receptor B, which we've abbreviated as PirB. And how do we know that this receptor is important for plasticity? Well, in mice, we can do a pretty easy experiment. We can genetically engineer the mice so that they grow up without this particular molecule. So this is a very straightforward thing to do in a mouse. And then it's called gene knockout, so the mice don't have this molecule. And then we can ask, okay, what happens to plasticity in the mice? And the amazing thing is that in these mice, normally there is plasticity, so anything greater than one on this scale is there's plasticity. We expected that if you knock out a gene that's needed for plasticity, there would be no plasticity. And that's true in this BDNF knockout. But amazingly, what we discovered is that in these PirB knockout mice, there's even more plasticity than normal. And not only that, there's some left in the adult. In other words, the critical period doesn't quite end, and there's more plasticity in their brains, even in the adult. And this made us wonder if there are also more synapses during development and in the adult in these mice. And the answer is yes. So we can actually, in the mice, label the synapses in green and count them all up. And we find that in the mice lacking PirB, there are more synapses, both in development and in the adult. So what does this mean? Think break here, right? So no PirB, the brake is off, which is really cool. So that made us wonder, wow, you know, it actually made me wonder, well, okay, where's the pill? I want the pill. Now, the problem is, right, we're not going to do genetic engineering and knockout in us anytime soon. So we actually have to make a pill. And the good news is, because we know something about the chemical structure of PirB, we can actually make a kind of protopill, and we can put it in the mouse brain, and we can ask what happens to the synapses. And if we put it into the adult mouse brain and wait a week, it turns out there are more synapses. So this is really amazing and really exciting in the sense that it is possible, at least in mice. So it is possible, using this kind of knowledge, to generate new connections in old brains in mice. So let me just then tell you the good news and sort of the bad news. So the good news is, this is a proof of concept. So we can engage molecular and cellular mechanisms, if we know about them, to reopen critical period-like plasticity in the adult brain. That's the good news. Another piece of good news is that it's there in us already, but braked. And by regulating these brakes and maybe accelerators, we can regulate the amount of brain plasticity that we have. Now, there are five of these PirB-like molecules in us, and only one in the mouse. We don't know which one it is in human. We got to work on that. I hope many other people are going to work on it. And finally, you know, I thought at first, wow, I want this pill, and I want to be the first one to take it. But the more I thought about it, I thought, you know, maybe that's not such a good idea, because maybe if I make new synapses for new learning, which is great, what's going to happen to what I already know? Thank you very much, everybody.